कविं कवीनामुपमश्रवस्तमम् ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पत आनश्रण्वन् नोतिभिः सीदसादनम् प्रणो देवी सरस्वती वाजेभिर्वाजिनीवती धीनामवित्र्यवतु गणेशाय नमः सरस्वत्यै नमः श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ यश्चन्दसां ऋषभो विश्वरूपः छन्दोभ्योऽध्यमृतासं बभूव समेन्द्रो मेधया शृणोतु अमृतस्य देवधारणो भूयासं शरीरं मे विचर्षणं जिह्वा मे मधुमत्तमा कर्णाभ्यां हूरिविश्रुवम् ब्रह्मण कोशोऽसि मेधया पिहितः श्रुतं मे गोपाय ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः मेधा देवी जुषमाणा न आगा विश्वाचि भद्रा सुमनस्य माना त्वया जुष्टानुदमाना दुरुक्तान् बृहद्वदेव विदथे सुवीराः त्वया जुष्ट ऋषिर्भवति देवि त्वया ब्रह्मा गतश्रीरुतत्वया त्वया जुष्टश्चित्रं विन्दते वसुसानो जुषस्वत्र विनो न मेधे मेधां महीन्द्रो ददातु मेधां देवी सरस्वती मेधां मे अश्विना उभावाधत्तां पुष्करस्रजा अप्सरासु चया मेधा गन्धर्वेषु चयन्मनः दैवी मेधा सरस्वती सामा मेधा सुरभिर्जुषत स्वाहा आमा मेधा सुरभिर्विश्वरूपा हिरण्यवर्णा जगति जगम्या ऊर्जस्वती पयसा बिन्वमाना सामा मेधा सुप्रतीका जुषन्तां मयि मेधां मयि प्रजां मय्यग्निस्तेजो दधातु मयि मेधां मयि प्रजां मयीन्द्र इन्द्रियं दधातु मयि मेधां मयि प्रजां मयि सूर्यो भ्राजो दधातु हंस हंसाय विद्महे परमहंसाय धीमहि तन्नो हंसः प्रचोदयात् ॐ साईश्वराय विद्महे सत्यदेवाय धीमहि तन्नः सर्वः प्रचोदयात् स्वस्ति प्रजाभ्यः परिपालयन्ताम् न्यायेन मार्गेण महीं महिषाः गोब्राह्मणेभ्यः शुभमस्तु नित्यम् समस्तलोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्तलोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु समस्तलोकाः सुखिनो भवन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः
सहनाभवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै शांति 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 ओम श्री साई राम ऑफरिंग माय मोस्ट हम्बल प्रणाम्स एट द लोटस फीट ऑफ आवर मोस्ट बिलवेड भगवान श्री सत्य साई बाबा विथ हिज डिवाइन ब्लेसिंग्स We are able to receive His grace in the form of today's episode of Gama Agama, a divine lecture series on Vedic knowledge initiated by Sri Satya Sai Seva Organization, India. On behalf of Sri Satya Sai Samyukta Shruti Shreni, I feel privileged to extend a warm welcome to all our fortunate Sai brothers and sisters who are watching this divine intellect enlightening program. Today, we have with us Srimati Karuna Swarup Munshiji as our guest speaker who will be expounding on the exposition of Gayatri Mantra. Welcome, ma'am, Sai Ram. Let us have an introduction about our guest of honor today. Since the late 1960s, Srimati Karuna Swarup Munshi grew up in a Sai-infused environment in Srinagar, Kashmir, where she attended the Presentation Convent School. She completed her high school from Singapore with high academic achievement. In 1980, she joined Sri Satya Sai Institute of Higher Learning, Anantapur campus, and graduated with a BA and MA philosophy from 1980 to 1985, securing a first rank and a gold medal, respectively. She was trained in electronic news gathering and documentary making at FTII Pune and the GOI's Central Processing Center at Asiad Village, New Delhi. She has worked as a TV journalist for Doordarshan News in the Ministry of Information and Broadcasting for the Government of India before she moved to Canada in 1991. She pursued communication studies at the University of Toronto. She is an experienced journalist and a communications expert who has held various eminent positions in India and Canada. Mrs. Karuna has served the Sai Mission in Canada for over two terms. She also taught SSE Group 3 and served as youth coordinator. She was the secretary of Sri Satya Sai School of Canada in Toronto for 9 years till she relocated to Puttaparthi along with her family. From 2007 to 2019, Mrs. Karuna Munshiji volunteered at Radio Sai hosting programs, producing documentaries, and contributing to content for its e-journal H2H. Concurrently, she taught English at the Sri Satya Sai Meerpuri College of Music for 2 years. Mrs. Karuna Munshiji is a grateful daughter of Sai Sevadal parents. She and her siblings and their children are former Sai students. Over to you, Mrs. Karuna Munshi, ma'am. Sai Ram.
श्रुतं मे गोपाय।
Everything is frozen for me, the screen. I won't know the thumbs up.
Saira ma'am, you can start.
Okay. Om Shri Sairam. Pranams at the lotus feet of the Veda Purusha, the Paripurna Avatar, our personal God, the most beautiful and beloved Bhagwan Shri Sathya Sai Baba. Loving Sairam and greetings from the Divine Valley of Prashanthi Nilayam to all my dear sisters and brothers. I hope everyone is doing well. A mathematical formula, a deeply embedded universal algorithm, the story of a warrior king whose obsession for a calf nearly drove him crazy, and a life protection plan with unlimited coverage. What could these seemingly unrelated topics have in common with the Gayatri Mantra? Perhaps everything and much more. Today we are here to decode the 24 syllables that have been trending for centuries, for ages, and for eons since eternity. And while we are at it, let's explore if it's viable to crack the code that runs the universe and in the process outsmart ourselves and the Illuminati. I hope you're up to it. Now, I'm going to lay out a few numbers before you. And first of all, I just want to mention, as I'm going along, if you have a question, please type it out in the YouTube chat box and it will reach me at the end of the show, of the presentation, not the show, wrong word, sorry. Now, do you think it's possible to lay out the mathematical table of creation and understand the wireframe, the structured design behind all phenomena, around us, above us, below us, and beyond us, far, far away into the infinity of all creation, and to investigate if it's a reflection of what is within us? So, is there an intelligent design in creation, and what is its pattern? Or is it a mere random sequence of accidents, events, jumps, and leaps? More importantly, if at all there is such a behind-the-scenes rhythm to all that manifests in creation, can we benefit from plugging into it? What do you think? Yes? No? Maybe? If yes, should we be aligned with it? And how does the alignment happen? How do we do it? Today, I'm going to lay out a few numbers on the table, primarily 8 into 3, that is 24, and the magic numbers 108 and 9. So please, tap these three numbers at the back of your minds, 24, 9 and 108. While we discuss the reductionist math of the Gayatri Mantra and its relationship with what the world today knows as the Fibonacci code, do I hope to do justice to this sacred incantation and its glory in the next 45 minutes or so? Let me seek an anticipatory bail from any such claim. But I am confident of one thing, that at the end of the session, you will realize what an ocean of benevolence and grace there is to experience when we embrace the Gayatri Mantra. Dear sisters and brothers, a powerful code has been encrypted into the oldest of the four Vedas, namely the Rig Veda. The Gayatri Mantra makes its debut in the third canto, the 62nd chapter, and the 10th verse of the Rig Veda. Interestingly, in the Rig Veda, at this location, it begins with the words Tat Savitur Vareniyam Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi Dhiyo Yo Naha Prachodayat. However, this mantra as we know today begins with the words Om Bhur Bhuva Swaha, and then comes the part I just said. Clearly, this line, the first line Om Bhur Bhuva Swaha, was added later on. The verses in the Vedas are organized in meters or rhythmic patterns called chandas in Sanskrit. The meter in which the Gayatri Mantra is set is also called Gayatri, and this Gayatri Chanda or the meter called Gayatri has many mantras set to rhythm apart from Gayatri Mantra. Some of the other mantras said to Gayatri Chanda or Gayatri meter are, for example, Mahalakshmi cha vidmahe, Vishnu patni cha dhimahi, Tanno Lakshmi prachodayat, or Ekadantaya vidmahe, or Saishwaraya vidmahe, Satya devaya dhimahi. All these are also said to the same meter. While each of these address a particular deity or a specific department of the divine cabinet of empowered ministers of finance and health and progeny and matrimony and whatnot, the most important mantra of universal potency that is laid out in this meter called the Gayatri Chanda is the Gayatri Mantra. It is considered the mother of all sacred incantations and therefore it is nicknamed Vedamata. It encompasses all the deities within it. It's a universal passport which fulfills all needs in life and afterlife at all levels of consciousness. So what exactly are mantras? Mantras are powerful healings and each offers a divine remedy from the cosmic burdens we carry, including the karmic baggage from earlier lives and from our present life choices. Gayatri Mantra is considered the most potent, the most exalted, and the easiest one. So full of divine power that anyone who chants it, no matter the cosmic burden they carry, they will fast track on the path of enlightenment. In the Gita 10.35, Lord Sri Krishna says, Gayatri Naam Chandasam Aham, meaning of all the Vedic meters, I am Gayatri. That's powerful stuff. The moment we invoke the meter of Gayatri, the rhythmic pattern, we are already plugged into the Krishna consciousness zone. It's like a spiritual Wi-Fi is switched on. On top of it, the moment the 24 syllables of the Gayatri mantra are laid out in the meter of the Gayatri Chanda, we open ourselves to an exalted state of blessings and benedictions. Now, we are talking about a 9G speed transmission. Why 9? There are 9 sounds to invoking her grace and please count with me. Om, Bhur, Bhuva, Swaha, Tat. And then you go Savitur for 6, Varenyam, Bhargo, Devase, 9. The number 9 is to be noted here. Dhimahi means we meditate upon. Diyo yo naha prachodayat, please shower your anugraha. So the 9 potent passwords open us to higher dimensions of thoughts, emotions and consciousness. How might that work out? Bhagwan Baba explains, Bhur refers to the Bhuvaloka, earth made of material. This world is a materialization, that is the physical level. Bhuva is the Swargaloka, Swaraloka, related to the mind, life at a vibrational level, mental. Suvaha refers to heaven or wisdom or Prajnana Brahma, radiation, spiritual. All 3, materialization, vibration and radiation are in us. These 3, the body, mind and spirit are not in another world but within us. This is what is called proximity, identity and merger, says Swami. Macrocosm in microcosm, microcosm in macrocosm, everything is within, everything is without, everything is set to the same perfection. Unknown to us and without our conscious awareness, this meter, this rhythm of the Gayatri Mantra holds the sacred algorithm. Algorithm to what, you may ask? For starters, all nature around us. The web and flow of life in more areas than you and I can possibly comprehend. It's an ocean to be discovered. In modern times, we are told that the Fibonacci code or a sequence of numbers suggests that the universe is based on a mathematical model which influences the rise and fall of waves, the perfection of the petals of flowers, the way the leaves grow on a stem, or the growth pattern of the rabbit population, or the movement of the stock markets. The Fibonacci sequence first appeared in a book called Liber Abaci, in Italian, which means the book of calculation, in 1202. And it was written by an Italian mathematician from the Middle Ages, and he's popularly known by the name of Fibonacci. The Fibonacci series is defined as follows. Every number is the sum of the 2 preceding ones. It's pretty simple. Starts with 0. 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, because 13 is 8 plus 5. The next number will be 21, because 21 is the sum total of 13 and 8, the two preceding numbers. So it goes on 34, 55, 89, 144. So the simplest way to calculate a Fibonacci number is simply to start at the beginning and work forward iteratively. This solution calculates all previous values, giving it an exponential running time. Large numbers take increasingly longer to calculate. But right here, let's just practice the pause and plunge straight into your financial portfolios. I'm sure most of you are invested in mutual funds and stocks. You follow the developments on Wall Street and the patterns on NASDAQ, Nifty 50, Nikkei Index. In the fintech analysis, a Fibonacci retracement is something that traders follow. And this Fibonacci retracement is created by taking two extreme points, usually a peak and a trough on a stock chart, and dividing the vertical distance by the key Fibonacci ratio, which is again the same pattern, 23.6%, 38.2%, 50%, 61.8%, and 100%. In short, the Fibonacci retracement levels stem from Fibonacci sequence of mathematical formula that originated in the 13th century. It is used to indicate key areas where a stock may reverse or stall. What is now today known as the Fibonacci levels, they are sort of frames through which traders look at their charts. This frame has the power to influence the trading decisions of thousands of traders. So if you're into trading, and these days with the meme stocks being so popular, perhaps you're trading on AMC, Cloverleaf, GameStop. If they are retracing, please be assured that they might be retracing as per the sequence that that Fibonacci code suggests. There are plenty of studies, plenty of theories on the retracement Fibonacci, and they suggest when to buy, when to sell a stock. My point here is to draw your attention to the expanse and depth of influence of this numerical sequence and how it seems to be all pervading from financial markets to nature and even to our spiritual blossoming. So please hold that thought right there. I'm jumping all over. So what the Western world may know today as the Fibonacci code, the spiritual scientists of India have been living it since the time of Vashishta and Vishwamitra. So coming up next is the story about the origin of the Gayatri Mantra in fast forward, because time is obviously, it's a very long story, and I'll keep it as crisp as I possibly can. And then we'll go through a little bit of reductionist arithmetic to understand how and why the Western concept of the Fibonacci code is essentially the blueprint of the Gayatri Mantra found in the Rig Veda. And most importantly, the utter simplicity involved in unlocking its potency, this potency of a sequence of phonics that revolve around the numbers 24, 108, and 9. How was Gayatri Mantra, this 24-syllable formula comprising of 9 main sounds, discovered and by who? It's time for a story. A long, long time ago, a powerful king named Kaushika was returning with his huge army after he had won a very difficult battle. He was victorious. His men were high on the euphoria of their victory, but sadly, they were very low on groceries and rations. In fact, they had run out of all food supplies. King Kaushika was very concerned. He didn't want to starve his loyal army to death even before they reached home to celebrate the victory. Someone in his troop suggested that there was possibly a small hermitage in the thick forest that they were passing through, and a sage lived there. So the king took a decision to take a little detour into the forest, and they went in search of a hermitage. And they were actually quite shocked to find that it was a bare bones, minimalistic infrastructure of dilapidated huts. There weren't any too many people around. But then there was an electrifying experience for the king when he came face to face with the sage who lived in that hermitage. And the sage had a great effulgence, a white flowing beard. His hair was matted and tied on top of his head. And his presence was so electrifying that the mighty king Kaushika just prostrated before this sage. And this sage happened to be Sage Vashishta. So the venerable sage welcomed this king, and he saw his men were very tired. He said to them, why don't you all go to the nearby river, take a quick dip in the river, take a bath, refresh yourselves and come back. Meanwhile, I will prepare food for all of you. The king thought it was rather funny because there was nobody around, no granaries, no kitchen visible, no big pots. So he said, with due respect, sir, I have a very huge army. I do not know if it will be convenient for you to prepare food for so many of us. But the sage was very calm. He replied to him. He said, dear king, you underestimate the power of penance. One of the greatest secrets of the universe is that when you are fulfilled, you can manifest almost anything in your life. The king was perplexed. He said, okay, whatever. He took his guys to the banks of the river. And when they approached the river, they realized it had been raining earlier. So the river was so muddy. The water was very muddy. He thought, this water is not even fit for a swim, let alone to drink. How on earth is he going to provide water and food to all of us? Nonetheless, they took their dip and they came back to the hermitage. And they were pleasantly surprised. They were served fresh, cool, and clean water in beautiful cups. And there were unending supplies of trays laden with hot and aromatic food. This was like freshly cooked, sumptuous meal. And these hungry army was just devouring it. The sage was a perfect host. He kept saying, please take some more. There's no dearth of anything. Eat to your heart's content. After everybody had a delicious and satisfying meal, the king couldn't hold back his curiosity. So he asked the sage, where on earth did all this food come from? I don't notice any cooks, any helpers, any big kitchens. The sage was very matter of fact. He said, Lord Indra has this cow called Kamadhenu. Kamadhenu is a wish-fulfilling cow. Now Indra has given me Kamadhenu's female calf named Nandini. And this divine calf, Nandini, fulfills my wishes. The king got super excited. He thought, my God, the old sage has an ATM machine at his disposal. And how wasted is this lovely, magical, mystical calf in a place like a hermitage in an ashram in the middle of a thick jungle? He asked the sage, how exactly does Nandini work? Can she grant anything that is asked of her? The sage was very calm. He said, Nandini can grant anything needed in the present moment, not anything for the future, because that goes against the rhythm and rules of nature. Nature never holds. Nature exists in the present, progressing from one moment to another. Therefore, the calf Nandini only provides whatever is needed now. Now, here's an interesting aside. The sage mentioned the rhythm of nature. So, you know, there is a code to which all of nature and the universe pulsates, but that's an interesting aside. Coming back to the story, the king said, that's fine, I can live with that, he thought. And what a boon it would be if he had the cow. He could replace his entire department of food and groceries when he went on wars, and no need to set up cooks, no need to have so many big vessels and groceries and supplies. In fact, Nandini could, as she did today, perhaps provide an all-you-can-eat buffet 3 to 4 times to his hardworking men. And what if she could also provide some arms and weapons if she's so wish-fulfilling? He psyched himself to believe that he really deserved her. And he just went to the sage. After all, he was the king. And he said, with due respect, Sage Vasishta, would you please hand over this beautiful calf Nandini to me? The sage was firm and he politely said, no, that cannot happen. So the calf is in my care and she's given to me by Indra only for the welfare of others, to feed the hungry people. The king was adamant. He was obsessed, possessed of this desire to take Nandini away. Negotiations went on. They became acrimonious and loud. There was no negotiation. It was one side. The king threatened the sage and he said, my entire army can take Nandini captive if she's not handed over politely to us. The sage would not budge. He claimed the calf was in his care, cannot be misused for worldly gains. And meanwhile, the calf whispered to the sage that she liked living with him in the hermitage. The sage assured her she would be safe. It was quite a standoff, to say the least. Meanwhile, the king's army started to close in on the sage and the calf. Just when Sage Vasishta, you know what he did? He whispered a mantra and he used a kriya called Stamban to stop all the soldiers in their tracks. As a result, an entire army of soldiers was frozen in their spots. They were transfixed. They couldn't move their limbs. They were so uncomfortable. After a few hours, they became restless and depressed, and their limbs were paining because they couldn't flex any of their joints. So eventually, the haughty emperor had to eat humble pie, and he has to ask for forgiveness from the sage. And that's when his men were released, and he left the hermitage feeling so deeply insulted because he had to concede defeat from a sage in front of his men, his military. Now think about it. A sage who carried no arms, he managed to defeat the entire army and the king just by the power of an incantation and a kriya. So the seething king returned home, and he was very upset, and he decided he had to seek revenge, and he denounced his kingdom, Kaushika, and he said he delegated responsibility to his ministers, and he decided to go on an intense penance for Lord Shiva. And he prayed, and eventually Shiva appeared, and he gave him the boons of the most sophisticated, because that's what he wanted, sophisticated, powerful weapons with which he would fight Sage Vasishta. He went back to the hermitage, asked one last time. Again, the sage declined, and then this made him really very upset. So he said, I asked you nicely, now it's war, because negotiations are not working. Nice is not working. So he started to launch one missile after another at the sage, who sat firm and unperturbed. And you know what the sage did? He just put a little staff called the Brahmadanda. He put a wooden staff of his in front of him. And this piece of wood that he placed in front of him absorbed all the energy from these nuclear warheads that king was throwing at him. No harm came to the sage or the calf. Now, again, the king was totally humiliated, and he went back. He was very upset with Shiva. He said his boons were not good enough. He would now perform thousands of years worth of more penance to other godheads and get more arsenal of weapons, which he did. And he came back again to fight for what? For Nandini the calf. And action replay, again, no luck. Now, this is when the kind sage felt sorry for the arrogant emperor. He realized he was just struggling because of his ego to acquire something that was not meant for him. He felt sad the king had wasted all these years of his penance seeking all the wrong boons for all the wrong reasons. So the enlightened sage, they're full of compassion. Therefore, he decided to reveal to the king the most ultimate secret. And he said, "It is not by power, O king, that is defeating you and your powers. It is, but who I am. You're not defined by what you have or what you can do, but by who you are, deep inside you. You have been doing all this penance to attain something while forgetting to invoke your own divinity. You're simply carrying some siddhis, but you're not tapping into your real source of power. My strength, O king, is not from my staff either. It is, but who I am." Now, this powerful divine discourse of Sage Vasishta proved to be the wake-up moment for the haughty king. And he realized that, he was just chasing the wrong target. And he decided he wanted to renounce and shun the hatred, the animosity, his obsession for weapons of mass destruction, and his obsession for Nandini the calf. And this was his eureka moment. He realized he wanted to change his goalpost in his sadhana and redefine his life's purpose. So he decided he would aim to reach the same level of superior consciousness that the sage had acquired. So much so that without using a single weapon or committing a single act of violence, Vasishta had defeated the king's entire army, disabled his most potent weapons, and he was so highly respected by Indra to have even received the divine calf. The gold standard to aspire for was right in front of the king. In a trice, he realized that his enemy was actually the role model he wanted to emulate. Thus, Kaushika undertook intense penance for a long, long, long time, during which he transformed his thoughts of anger and desire to those of Samasta Loka Sukhino Bhavantu. He wished well for all sentient beings everywhere. After much sincere sadhana, with his inner eye, Kaushiki saw the most magical, the most mystical of all mantras that had the power to pull anyone out of any adversity or danger. It was a congregation of divine sounds that could dispel ignorance and rescue anyone in any situation. It had the power to help one realize one's divine nature. For the rest of his life, the Gayatri Mantra, set to Gayatri Chanda or meter, became the only mantra that King Kaushika ever invoked. From a trigger-happy king obsessed with conquest, victory, and power, Kaushika transformed into a sage who ruled hearts of others by democratizing access to the most potent of mantras that he had discovered after a lot of hard work, and he readily shared it with all humanity. In recognition of his generosity to share this precious passport to another dimension of consciousness towards enlightenment, to radiance, guidance, benevolence, and divine grace, he was recognized as the greatest friend to whole humanity and came to be known as Vishwamitra. The word Vishwa refers to the world and Mitra means friend. This potent revelation was a series of mystical sounds set, as I did say earlier, to a specific meter. It had the power to unlock infinite powers latent within oneself. Now, this extreme emotional, spiritual, physical makeover of a warring king to become friend of the universe involved the discovery and then chanting of the Gayatri Mantra, not like a parrot to keep some count or how many malas, you know, standing on one foot like a tree in a tree pose of yoga. No, not at all. The meta science of the Gayatri Mantra involves chanting as per the mantra science laid out in the Vedas. And we will come back to that later, as Bhagwan Baba has explained it in very simple language for the dummies of the Kali Yuga like us in his many, many discourses. Thousands of years after sage Vishwamitra discovered this formula of the Gayatri Mantra, our dear friend Leonardo Pisano Bigolo, the Italian mathematician better known as Fibonacci, it appears, also had his moment of enlightenment. Being mathematically inclined, Fibonacci discovered, or rather rediscovered, the back-end wireframe, the algorithm of what was known to Vedic sages for thousands and thousands of years before Fibonacci's time. Fibonacci's awakening was limited to the numerical sequence involved in the Gayatri Chanda or the meter. No spiritual incantation was revealed to him, or so it appears. Perhaps, my guess is he would have to reincarnate in the sacred land of Bharat to receive that part of the boon. Now, Vedas are extensive repositories of knowledge of various domains. For example, you all know Ayurveda, it's so popular, it deals with the knowledge of health and well-being. And today, if all of us are consuming copious quantities of organic turmeric for boosting our immunity against COVID, because, you know, JAMA, the Journal of American Medicine or the British Journal of Medicine has published research to confirm that turmeric has curcumina, which boosts our immunity and has anti-inflammatory properties. Let's not forget that Ayurveda had integrated this knowledge into the daily living of Bharatiyas thousands of years ago. That's why turmeric is integral to Indian cooking. And it is also a known fact that turmeric performs best when it is fat soluble, and it performs better when it's mixed with black pepper, pepperina. Now, most Indian cooking include these, include oil or ghee, and which is clarified butter, as well as pepper, black pepper. So you get my drift. Just it has existed as part of the Indian civilization from Vedic times. Similarly, Sanskrit prosody or chandas is one of the six limbs of Vedic studies called the Vedangas that deal with the poetic meters and verse in Sanskrit. What is today known as the Fibonacci numbering sequence appeared thousands of years earlier in the Sanskrit prosody as chandas, or as an arrangement of a fixed number of syllables per verse. This area of study is essential to understand the composition of the Vedas. The Gayatri Chanda, or the Sanskrit prosody, is a repository of a metrical tradition that revolves around the sequence of numbers that repeat after every 24 times or 24 numbers. And please note they always add up to a number which reduces itself eventually to 9. For example, 18 or 108 or 27. All of these are reduced to number 9. This is part of Rig Veda. This is part of Vishwamitra. Please bear the sequence in mind and the context in which I am sharing the Sanskrit prosody information with you. Now let's move forward thousands of years to the Middle Ages. The sum total of the first 24 numbers on the Fibonacci code starting with 0 add up to 108, which is 1 plus 0 plus 8 equal to 9. This pattern reoccurs after every 24 counts. You can try it out for yourself. I did with a brother who's good at math and is accurate. And that's how the cycle goes. This concept of Fibonacci sequence of numbers where each number is a sum of the previous two has appeared in Indian ancient scriptures in Pingala's cryptic formula, Misrauchcha. The two are mixed. You know when? In 450 BC to 200 BC. Interestingly, Bharata Muni also expresses the knowledge of the same number sequence in the Natya Shastra, 100 BC to 350 AD. Remember, I asked you to hold your thought earlier when I spoke of the Fibonacci sequence and its influence on the stock market. Now, it dictates that the pattern that stock markets follow when prices peak, shoulders, graphs form candles or crash, whether you follow Nifty 50, Nasdaq, anything, behind all the drama involving billions of sells, buy, puts, options, there is an algorithm that modern economists may attribute to what they know as the Fibonacci code. It is widely used for financial forecasting. What do they know? What existed before Fibonacci? Now, Fibonacci sequence also appears in biological settings, such as the branching in trees or the arrangement of leaves on a stem, or the fruitlets on a pineapple, or the flowering of an artichoke, or the uncurling of the fern, on the arrangement of the pine cone, or the family tree of the honeybees. It was Johannes Kepler who pointed out the presence of the Fibonacci sequence in nature, and he used it to explain what is known as the golden ratio, the pentagonal form of some of the flowers like field daisies. Incidentally, the Pentagon, which is the military head office of the American Army in Washington, D.C., as the name suggests, is designed along the patterns of the Fibonacci code with angles set at 108 degrees. You may recall it was the least damaged as compared to the twin towers of the World Trade Centers during the 9/11 attacks. Closer to home, one of the several national programs that the Sri Satya Sai Vidyavahini is involved in is with the Niti Aayog, which is the government of India's think tank. While we work to improve the learning outcomes in an aspirational district of Virudhunagar, we have been requested by the government to scale our projects. And we have decided we will scale it block after block following the Gayatri Chanda. Some of you, thanks to our Western education, may recognize it at the Fibonacci sequence. More power. We hope to assess the impact of such a progression plan once we have completed the entire project with Bhagwan's blessings by Bhagwan's 100th birthday. So now, let's deconstruct the sequence that is the secret blueprint of nature, of the universe, of each of its components, their rhythm down to the granular level. As we begin to crack the code that forms this algorithm of the universe, which modern naturalists, botanists attribute to a number sequence, please continue to keep in mind my three favorite numbers for today, 24, 108, and 9. Fibonacci code has a pattern that repeats every 24 numbers. How? This is done by numeric reduction. As an example, you know, I've been asked by the organizers of this session if I wanted to screen share. I chose deliberately not to because I'm expecting all of you highly evolved souls to please take a moment to open your third eye and see whatever, to have a visual representation before your mind's eye of everything I'm sharing with you. And I'm sure you're all very capable of it. It's a very deliberate impact because I think Gayatri Mata is right now illuminating all our intellects. So how does numeric reduction work? Let's take the number 256. Now I see the reduction of 256 is 4, How did I arrive at 4? 256. 2 plus 5 plus 6 is equals to 13. And 13 is 1 plus 3 equals to 4. Now, when we apply this numeric reduction to the Fibonacci series, it produces an infinite series of 24 repeating digits. 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 4, 3, 7, 1, 8, it goes on. And how are these 20? And every time the 24 number loop ends, it adds to a number which adds up to either 9999, 108, 9999, and everything when you reduce it, first level, second level, third level of reduction, it comes down to number 9. Now, how does the 24 number sequence of the Fibonacci code show up in the Gayatri Mantra? The Gayatri Mantra is composed of a meter consisting of 24 syllables. They are arranged in triplets of 8 syllables each. 8 multiplied by 3 is 24. That's why this particular meter, Gayatri Chanda, is also referred to as Tripadi. 3 times, right? 3 times 8. So what are these 24 syllables? I will read them out and I suggest you count on your fingers. Tat, remember how it appears in Rig Veda? It doesn't start with Om Bhurbhuvah Svaha. So work with me here. Tat, Sa, Vi, Tur, Va, Re, Ni, Yam, Bhar, Go, Di, Va, Sya, Dhi, Ma, Hi, Dhi, Yo, Yo, Nah, Pra, Cho, The Yat. This is the list of 24 syllables that make the Gayatri Mantra. Now, each of these syllables represents a great quality. For example, when I say Tat, it means Tapini. Sa, Safalta. Vi, Vishwas. So, I'm not going to read the full form of each of the Sanskrit words. In fact, I just might as well. Why don't I? So, Tat stands for Tapini, which means mystical. Sa for Safalta, victorious. V for Vishwas, confident, persevering. Content, blessed, abundant or resourceful, refined, intuitive. Bhargav means fulfilled. Sacred, innately divine, naturally attuned, determined, focused, exemplary, truthful, wise, spiritually empowered, one with God, wealthy and generous, influential, enthusiastic, outstanding, pleasing and peaceful. So on the physical plane, these 24 powers or siddhis can be obtained from each of the 24 syllables of the Gayatri Mantra. Each sound is potent. It stands for a quality. Its arrangement and notation activate it to draw from within us these qualities to unravel our divine personality. Swami has said we can discover talents we did not even know we have within us if we unlock them. And the key to unlock them is the sequence. The 24 powers that are within us make us completely divine. As I said, they are mystical, victorious, confident, content, abundant, resourceful, and so on. Now, anyone who has, and I like the last one, it says internally peaceful and equipoised. Anyone with those qualities would be a natural leader. Personally, I can only think of one being who personified all of the above and surpassed them with this infinite love. So if you can guess who I'm thinking of, I'm asking you, dear sisters and brothers, mention the name in the comment box of your YouTube page. My question to you is, who is it that I'm thinking of as the absolute exemplar of all the 24 qualities that Gayatri Mantra highlights and goes beyond them? If you can mention the name of who you think I'm thinking of, and you can also mention if you know somebody who personifies them. So by the way, Swami says nature is our best teacher, and Bhagavatam says that there are 24 gurus from a common bird to the sun that we can learn from. So 24 is a number of great interest in the Vedic tradition. So today, what I'm placing before you is the premise that Fibonacci only rediscovered a sequence pattern that repeats every 24 numbers. It already existed as the meter of the Gayatri Mantra since the time of the Rig Veda. Numeric reduction is a technique, as I told you, that is used to analyze number in which all the numbers, digits of a number are added until they are reduced to a single digit. Example, I told you of 2, 5, 6 would be 4 because 2 plus 5 plus 6 is 13. So in 13, I do 1 plus 3 equals to 4. And when I take the same thing, the first 12 numbers also of the, it's an infinite series in the Fibonacci sequence. I can produce an infinite series of 24 repeating digits. And as I said, each of them will eventually, the loop will always close with the value of 9. Now, this pattern was contributed both by Joseph Turberville and again by a mathematician by the name of Jain, J-A-I-N. I'm assuming he's Indian. I could not do much more research to get to know more about Jain. There's a lot written about him, but who is Jain is a mystery. Now, maybe Gayatri Mata will help us unravel that. Clearly, in the Fibonacci series, each number, of course, we know it encodes the sum of the two previous ones. But what is not quite so obvious to the Western thinkers is why this pattern should repeat every 24 numbers and why the first and last half of the series should always add up to the number 9. For those of you who are in that show me state of mind, keep your third eye open because I'm zooming there. This pattern of 24 digits is demonstrated in the numeric reduction of all the first 73 numbers, and I will explain without screen sharing. I'll take the first number, 2584. It's a big number. When I reduce it to the first level of reduction, it becomes 2 plus 5 plus 8 plus 4 equals to 19. So then I go to the second level of reduction. My number is 19, right? So 1 plus 9 is equals to 10. Then I go to the final level of reduction. I have the number 10 on my hands. 1 plus 0 equals to 1. So 2, 5, 8, 4 in the first level of reduction comes down to 19. In the second level, it comes down to 10 and eventually it comes down to 1. And then I, the brother who is the mathematician who taught me, when we went through the number reduction of the Fibonacci code, and initially, when we started counting the first 24 from number 1, because Fibonacci code starts from 0, 0, 1, 1, we started from 1, we got a wonky number and our math went haywire. And then we realized, oops, we should start from 0. So when you start 0 as your first, then 1 as your second number, second 1 as your third number, the 24th number always, always perfectly adds up to 108 and reduces itself to number 9. So, one more interesting fact is that the ancient Indians, they knew the value of zero. You know, India gave zero to the world of mathematics, shunya, zilch, nada, whatever you call it. All mathematical formulas work better with zero and become coherent. And that's why the Fibonacci code actually is exactly designed as per the golden ratio, as per the meter of the Gayatri Chanda, the Tripadi. And in reality, these the Fibonacci code and the golden ratio are nothing but rediscoveries of the by the human brain of truths that are all there. Knowledge is all around us. We just have to tap into it and grab it. And Sage Vishwamitra got it at a higher state of consciousness, and he got a two-part formula, a meter and incantation, whereas Fibonacci obviously only received the meter. So the cadence of the powerful sounds or the meter of Tripadi or Gayatri, when it's woven around the powerful rhythm of these 24 important potent syllables that I read out to you, it has a very rare power. It can align our inner rhythm to the beat of creation. It can align us to the divine source or divine worship, Mata Gayatri. And it's like having an uninterrupted Wi-Fi connection between the motherboard and rest of the systems on the network called creation. So Gayatri is an efficient route to source our intuition. You can ask any practitioner of Gayatri Mantra what it does for them, and they will vouch that it sensitizes us to all that happens around us. Gayatri amplifies the greater voice of ourselves, our God selves, our conscience. Actually, it's a feeling that comes from the gut. If something doesn't feel right, the conviction to not do it will come naturally from the practice of Gayatri Mantra. Many times in life, we are faced with confusion and we don't know what to do. At such times, get still, be very still, and meditate on the Gayatri until our internal motivation and clarity is what drives our situation. Remember, the wise live their lives from inside out. The cardinal principles of mantra science that come into play when we chant the Gayatri Mantra with faith are that we acquire discretion, that sense of discerning wisdom or a sharpened intuition, and a generally positive outlook in life. All these are priceless life skills that no leadership school can teach us. Correct chanting and loving meditation on the Gayatri Mantra puts us in the sentiment of our deity, right behind me. Some may call it Devi Bhava, not to pretend to be God, but to be a person with the godly outlook, godly attitude, godly nature. So by this continuous inner chanting in a state of mindfulness, Gayatri is not what we utter. Gayatri is what we become, or rather, who we become. The effulgence of the Devi becomes visible in our personality. Her Vak Siddhi resounds in our speech, which becomes loving and truthful and sparing and effective. It's a very well-known fact that Gayatri practitioners have a magnetic personality that exudes confidence and evokes trust from others. I am challenging you to just observe the people in your life around you whom you trust. Personal and professional life can become more enjoyable and meaningful, and Gayatri can put us really ahead of the game if we include her in all that we do, because she's a magical incantation that will put the right people in our life at the right time for the right reasons to guide us onwards without any difficulty. Now, the wisdom and maturity to recognize this divine intervention will come from spiritual sensitivity that Gayatri develops and defines in us. Thus, the Gayatri helps us to spot an opportunity. Sharp discernment. My personal favorite benefit of the practice of Gayatri Mantra is that it makes you vibrationally so sensitive that you can assess situations, characters, intentions, and motives of those around you with piercing clarity. If you are into chanting Gayatri Mantra, I'm sure you will agree with me. And this life skill is very useful. Now, in his book, A Whole New Mind, author Daniel Pink says that we are now entering a whole new age, a conceptual age, where the traits that set people apart today are going to come from our heart, our right brain, and our head. Gayatri illumines all three with her effulgence. The logical, linear, rules-based thinking is not all that matters in the current age. Empathy, joyfulness, purpose, inner traits that transcendent value are intrinsically relevant in today's world. All these positive traits bloom when we do what we love doing, because when we do what we love doing, we involve the wholeness of our being into our efforts. This heightened state of involvement, commitment, and satisfaction from work we do is the outcome of the brilliant divine light from within that breaks all mental barriers of I, my work, and my doing, and merges what is perceived as three different components into one. And dear brothers and sisters, I am a personal witness to such integration of the doer, the doing, and the task at hand, and the miraculous outcomes of such evolution, because I am honored to work with Sri Sathya Sai Vidya Vahini volunteers. These are cadres of highly qualified, professionally successful, experienced men and women and youth who take up a task from the wholeness of their being, and they do it as though this is their ashtotram, this is their atirudram homam, this is their sadhana. When they bring the wholeness of their being into the task, the results are simply divine and they speak for themselves. The Gayatri Mantra amplifies this one big takeaway from the infinite wisdom of the Vedas. Gayatri Mantra is verily the heart of awareness, that we are all divine beings of infinite potential and capabilities, and we are here to play a part, a role in a drama called the human experience. The power of Gayatri, of course, as I said, lies in its luminosity as it awakens the effulgence of the sun within. There is a sun. We see everything from the prism of our true self. I am divine. The world around me is a projection of the same divinity. The light is in me. I am in the light, and I am the light. Remember what Vasishtha told Kaushiki, the mighty king, that finally made him concede defeat? It is not my power, O king, the sage said. It is but who I am. You're not defined by what you have or what you can do, but by who you are deep inside you. So Gayatri awakens that who I am identity as a divine being in each of us. Moreover, the same light is the power it reminds us in everything around us. The diversity around me is a variety of masks of form that the same God is assuming. Nature is verily God. Everybody around me is also God. So Gayatri plays the role of a synchronizer. It synchronizes our pulse to the beat and rhythm, to beat in rhythm and sync with the heartbeat of a much larger or rather infinite universe of which we are a minuscule part. Now, as a resident of the Divine Valley of Prashanthi Nilayam, every time I travel outside this vibrational zone of the Divine Valley, I get rather stressed and disturbed by the noise, by the traffic, especially when I go to Bangalore for some essential work. And the malls, I'm like totally like a fish out of water. And on my way back, I have a very specific milestone where my entire system goes through a reboot and a reset back to normal. It's like all my systems are haywire, and all of a sudden, someone gives a, you know, a 10-second press on your computer and then you reboot. That's exactly what happens. And my heart starts to beat perfectly normal. I'm at ease. My mind is relaxed and I have this big smile on my face. So can you imagine where my milestone is? I'm sure you have one too. I'm happy to share mine. Mine is that big welcome gate at the Gorantla Cross before our super hospital. And guess what? It is exactly 9 kilometers from Prashanthi Nilayam from that spot. So if you're coming from Bangalore, you come from Mangalakara and all those places. If you're coming from the railway, so you come from your right. And when you're coming from the SSPN railway station, Sri Satya Sai Prashanthi Nilayam railway station, you come from the left. And both the roads meet at that crossing called Gorantla Cross. And you see this beautiful, the arches of Prashanthi Nilayam with Bhagwan's photograph and the beautiful clear road, palm trees on the center median. And that's where I experienced my reset. And that's what Gayatri is supposed to do overall, so that we don't have anxiety issues. We don't have stress issues. I hope you can relate to what I'm saying. If I sound crazy, I guess I'm guilty. As found. Now, in the human body, the trillions of cells within us pulsate with the same energy, and individually, each cell is a representation of the same rhythm of our heartbeat, both the physical heart and the heart chakra, which beats at a vibrational level. Similarly, the Gayatri mantra is the algorithm of the universal heartbeat. You and I and all creation around it are all like tiny cells in the body of God. And we too dance to the same rhythm. We too perform the same tandava. We too tap to the same damaru, of course, differently according to our karmic blueprint. It's kind of customized, bespoke arangetram each of us has according to our karma. You might be dancing Odissi and somebody's doing Kathak and somebody's doing Bharatanatyam. The taal or the beat of the universe is synchronized with the tiniest aspect of nature, and at that deep, deep level, all is held in the same web of divinity. Om Purnamada, Purnamidam, Purnat, Purnamudachate, Purnasya Purnamadaya, Purnameva Avashishate. If a spoonful of sugar is sweet, so is the single tiny crystal of sugar. perfection in nature as a whole at macro level, perfection in nature at a micro level, also in each tiny part. The heartbeat of the universe, the heartbeat of all forms of nature, the pulsing of each cell, same to same symphony. Remember the pulse rate, pulse beat, 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, so on, so forth. And it is always going to add up to 108, 999 or something, and then it is going to be reduced to number 9. And the pattern will repeat after every 24 numbers. So if a brilliant Italian mathematician discovered a formula in 1202, good for him, Vedic scientists and mathematicians have been using it for a very long time, along with the 24-syllable incantation to achieve substantial spiritual progress for ages, ever since sage Vishwamitra received it in deep meditation. And then he so generously, he didn't keep it to himself and patent it and make it his intellectual property. No, he shared it with the whole world. Therefore, the Gayatri Mantra is the finest statement of the highest truth, beyond which lies only one remaining experience. And guess what it is? Silence. Gayatri has the power to allow us to abide in that state of consciousness of absolute stillness, where we feel a deep connect with everything and everything as an extension. The tree outside my window is an extension of my lungs, because I exhale a certain gas, the tree absorbs it. The tree gives me oxygen, I inhale it. Everything. There are no prejudices. Gayatri allows us to look past the external differences. Actually, it's the giant leap in human consciousness. And Gayatri enables us to overcome prejudices of race, religion, caste, culture, skin color, hair texture, and so on. And if there is one place where you can witness such a melting pot where ethnic, racial diversity all unite rather than divide people, now I can only think of one place, and that would obviously be Prashanti Nilayam, India, which is the spiritual capital of the universe. And I can't think of another holy place where Christians and Hindus and Parsis and Sikhs and Jews and Muslims have free and fair access to blessings and freedom to worship God as per their faith. Can you think of any such place? Think. I can't. I tried. The second best that came to my mind, which is not a religious place, is perhaps Times Square in New York City. And you know which other place? LaGuardia Airport in New Jersey, where Arabs and Indians and Orientals and East Europeans, everyone has a kiosk selling falafels and pizzas and samosas and noodles and Manchurian and whatnot. But jokes aside, let's get back to the main topic. How the Fibonacci code is a modern day mathematical expression of a numeric sequence that is already present in the Gayatri Mantra, which is found in the Rig Veda. And how woven along this numeric wireframe are the sacred sounds that make the Gayatri Mantra the divine alchemy to cope with the pressures of modern life. We have to taste, if I can describe to you some amazing sweet that I'm capable of making, but I can go all I want to tell you what I add and what I dissolve and what my recipe is, but you got to taste it to experience it, right? The taste of the pudding lies in its, the proof of the pudding lies in its taste. So what Gayatri does, you have to embrace it to realize that it brings such clarity and it dissolves confusion. And very importantly, Gayatri allows us to align our passion with our purpose, our emotion with our expertise. And this makes life so solid and so meaningful. Gayatri empowers us to honor our calling with confidence. Social pressure, peer pressure, please don't bog down the practitioner of Gayatri. This confusion and conflict between social expectations and inner calling is something that's plaguing modern society. I believe Gayatri Mantra is the greatest life guide that cuts through this specific confusion. I meet enough people in my life who want to live their life a certain way, but they're expected to live a certain way. And you know, you can't give advice. The advice has to come from within. Also, if in life you experience any negativity directed at you, remember Vashishtha had a Brahmadanda that absorbed all the nuclear warheads that were being shot at him and reflected the light back at King Kaushika, blinding him with the brilliance, And meanwhile, Vashishtha and the calf Nandini remained unscathed. Anybody who chants the Gayatri Mantra has a force field around them of divine protection, is impregnable. It will neutralize all negativity and we will remain unscathed in our spiritual journey and life journey. So in the beginning, I told you I'm going to tell you of an unlimited life protection plan. Keep that in mind. Please also bear in mind that Sanatan Dharma is all-inclusive. Sanatan Dharma is barriers-free and broad-minded. In this way of life, in the culture of the Bharatiyas, there are no restrictions to who can chant the Gayatri Mantra. It is open to all. After all, the Agama tradition of the Vedas qualify the materialistic world with spiritual undertone. One can live a material life, fulfill our worldly obligations without getting attached to them. A true hermit does not need to leave the household. One can live as a family person, but think like a hermit. In our tradition, we hear of a Shiva getting married. We hear of Rama ruling a kingdom at the cost of personal happiness. And Krishna, the prankster, eventually witnesses the horrors of civil war. There are no watertight compartments when it comes to playing roles, nor any barriers to spiritual opportunities in Sanatan Dharma. One can be a family man on the outside, but a hermit on the inside. Speaking of family man, you can be Srikant Tiwari, the family man on the outside, top spy on the inside. Those of you who watch OTT will get me. So live in the world without losing sight of who we are and what is our life's purpose. That is the clarity that Gayatri confers. And that is why it makes sense to align ourselves with her benevolence and with her grace. Actually, there is a repository of stories on the power of Gayatri Mantra playing out in real life situations and helping people, but that's a satsang for another time. The last word on today's satsang will again belong to the source, the supreme source, the Veda Purusha, the voice of the Vedas, Bhagwan Sri Satya Sai Baba. Today, here's what our beautiful effulgent Sai Ma has said about the Gayatri Mantra and said it so simply, to make it understandable for everyone. This is what is inclusion, really. Baba says, and I quote him, Gayatri Sarva Devata Swarupini, Sarva Mantra Swarupini. And it is said, Gayatri Chandasam Mata, meaning Gayatri is the mother of the Vedas. There is no need to chant any other mantra if you chant the Gayatri Mantra. Gayatri has three names, Gayatri, Savitri, and Saraswati. Gayatri is the master of the senses. Savitri is the presiding deity of the life principle. And Gayatri acts as the protector of the life force. At that time, she is known as Savitri. And Saraswati confers Vak Siddhi. Swami goes on to say Gayatri is the mother of the Vedas and she is Panchamukhi. She has five faces. The faces that Bhagwan describes, Om, Bhurbhuva Swaha, Tat Savitur Varenyam, Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi, Diyoyona Prachodayat. Where does Mata Gayatri reside? Of course, apart from Prashanthi Nilayam, that's her image of the Prashanthi Nilayam Gayatri Mata behind me. She Gayanti Trayate Iti Gayatri. Gayatri resides within the one who meditates upon her. What is her uniqueness? She is Sarva Devata Swarupini, Swami confirms. When we pray to Gayatri, our prayers reach the entire divine cabinet. It's like having access to the Prime Minister's office. If you want to get something sorted from the government, you have to go through a lot of layers of bureaucracy and then through the ministry and then it will go to PMO. But if you have access to the Prime Minister and you have dinner with him every night, I bet you the individual ministries and the bureaucrats will be at your disposal. This is what happens when you tap into the Gayatri Mantra. All the divine deities are included within this chant. So what are some of the benefits? Swami has categorically stated that anyone, an aspirant who chants Gayatri will be successful in all worldly and spiritual pursuits. Yes, all. And don't think, what about if I have a sinister plan, will Gayatri help me to rob a bank? Once you chant Gayatri, such plans will fall by the wayside because she blesses us only with good thoughts. She doesn't allow bad thoughts to sprout in her mind. She provides a mother's protection. She activates the power of Saraswati, who is the Vak Devata Swarupini, and daily chanting removes bad thoughts from our mind and toxins from the body. Detoxing is so hip and in. Here's a solution. Chant the Gayatri, the toxins will leave. Swami Bhagwan also advises to induct children into Gayatri at a young age because they will develop both practical wisdom and divine knowledge. And referring to the universality, Swami says, when to chant, anytime you need a spiritual reboot, there are no barriers to chanting time for Gayatri. However, it is most effective if chanted thrice at least in a day, a.m., noon and bedtime. If you have been through the sacred thread ceremony known as Yagnopavitam or Upanayanam, Bhagwan advises you must chant your Gayatri mantra daily. So if you have received the Gayatri mantra, the gift of Gayatri mantra, of the Upanayanam, please chant your Gayatri. One may chant Gayatri also while taking a shower, because then the bath becomes an abhishek for the sacred temple, which is the body, within which resides the divine Atma. If Gayatri is chanted before eating food, it will be like offering Naivedyam to the mother. Now, where can we chant Gayatri? Should I chant sitting east, west, facing this, facing that? Swami said anywhere, as long as it is done with due awareness and reverence. You can chant it while driving, while waiting on the bus stop, in a doctor's office, no problem. Who can chant? Is it restricted to certain class of people, certain gender? Excuse me, no barriers in Sanatana Dharma, no distinction of gender, caste, religion. And anyone, anywhere can chant the Gayatri. Finally, Swami says, there is but one law, the law of karma, and no one can escape its grip or outsmart it with cleverness, with intelligence, with money, power, political connection. But in this statement, there is a small asterisk attached, which means some terms and conditions apply even to the law of karma. And Swami says, if there is one mantra that can reduce, remove, annihilate our cosmic burden from earlier lives or from poor current life choices, it is only one. And that only one mantra is the Gayatri mantra. So as his devotees, instead of running from one astrologer to another, seeking advice or pariharams and remedies to fix our fate, if we abide by Bhagwan's advice and chant the Gayatri mantra with all our heart and soul and liver and kidney in every breath with love and reverence, the stranglehold of our karmas will be loosened and Mata Gayatri will write a new destiny for each one of us. With Gayatri's grace, it is like the effect of a medicine expires after a certain date, the effect of our karmic burdens expires with the chanting of the Gayatri mantra. She is the passport to living a fear-free life. Gayatri mantra, essentially, ladies and gentlemen, is the finest life navigation system. The sooner we install it into our lives, the better. And regular practice ensures timely updates automatically, no cost. Once we experience the joy of being in the company of her divine majesty, Empress Gayatri, all the inner upheaval transforms into acceptance and bliss. As I said earlier, the ultimate experience that lies on the other side of Gayatri, beyond Gayatri, is singular, utter stillness and silence. So, are we ready to chant it with the Veda Purusha, with the voice of the Vedas, with the goddess Gayatri Mata herself? Admin, Srikant, please be ready to play the three chantings of the Gayatri Mantra in Bhagwan's divine voice. And dear sisters and brothers, I urge each one of you to meditate on her effulgence and chant along with Swami. One last principle of mantra science I must share. It is advisable that we chant this powerful affirmation of our divinity, the way Bhagwan chants it, as per the grammar of the Gayatri Chanda or Gayatri meter, rather than some filmy tunes that are available commercially. Those Gayatri CDs or Gayatri mantras may sound catchy, like jingles of an advertisement, but those don't honor the version that sage Vishwamitra discovered. So, Over now to Gayatri Mata herself. I pray to Bhagwan to right now initiate once again all of us into this potent passport to joy, effulgence, and success in His divine voice. Edmund, please go ahead.
सवितुर्वरेण्यम् भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात् सवितुर्वरेण्यम् भर्गो देवस्य धीमहि धियो यो नः प्रचोदयात्।
ॐ श्री साईराम। साईराम मैम, on behalf of our Veda Poshana family, I would like to thank you from the bottom of my heart for sharing such a deeper knowledge which was no less than nectar. I would like to summarize today's session precisely. Our respected speaker ma'am emphasized beautifully on the magical numbers 9, 24, 108. She decoded the 24 syllables of the divine Gayatri mantra. She explained the Vedic meter, the chanda, the cardinal outcomes of the mantras on our lives, the four Vedas and the Upaveda, Ayurveda too, Trigonachi's sequence of its impact on everything in the universe, the secret blueprint of the universe, story of the origin of sacred Gayatri mantra by sage Vishwakarma, how this mantra illumines us on social, spiritual, material, I mean all the levels and in all the lokas. Unlimited life protection plan, which was a secret till now, but no more secret now onwards. The power of who I am, I mean, wow, it was wonderful. She even captured the youth's heart by mentioning words like OTT platform and family men, etc. So I once again wholeheartedly thank you, want to thank you, our respected speaker ma'am, on behalf of our Veda Poshana family. And now I would like to announce a small thing, which is like viewers can now post their queries in the chat box and few relatable questions will be picked by our speaker ma'am herself, and she is willing to answer your queries. So viewers, your queries are invited in the chat box. Sai Ram.
So I am told there are no questions.
Yes.
So I don't know what to make of it, dear sisters and brother. Is it that I bored you so out of your minds that you have no question, or is this the silence, the stillness that follows Gayatri? I'll go with the second. I'll go with answer B for my own satisfaction. You're all in an elevated state of consciousness right now.
Actually, there is no scope for questions, I think, because everything we are contemplating on whatever you were talking, you were telling.
Okay, good. Please go. I hope I've given you some food for thought, and I hope there are people out there who'd like to do their research, maybe a PhD on this, especially if they are from the field of mathematics and metaphysics. And this is so much to explore. When I started reading for this lecture, my God, I was confronted with an ocean of information. I really had to summarize and keep it very simple. Okay, somebody has asked a question. It comes from Ashish Sharma. In daily chanting, how much time one should chant? It's entirely up to you, brother, depending on your schedule. Remember number 9? I would say 3 is a good start, because normally we chant Gayatri thrice, Tripadi, remember? But if your time permits, 9 times in a sitting would be very nice. And or you can do 3. If you're very, very busy, 3 in the morning, 3 in the noon, 3 at bedtime. 3 Gayatris, but ideally, if you can, 108 would be wonderful. And I have many times long ago tried that thing of doing 100, my family and I, we would sit and do 108 for, let's say, 18 days as a little practice. It was fantastic. It had quite an impact on everything, on our health, on our home, on our general well-being, the energy in the house. It's phenomenal. But Swami again says, don't do it like a mathematician. You're not an accountant. Just pray from your heart, and every time you can. I typically like to chant it in many tasks that I do, whether it's cooking or chopping or for bath, for eating, anything. I very, very much like to include this as part of my practice. And whenever I'm overwhelmed with a little bit of work and I'm feeling stressed, I take a pause and I chant my Gayatri to do my reboot and resetting. And then I go ahead and I continue. So it's not, you don't need a chartered accountant to keep account of, you know, how many you chanted and what are you going to get. Whatever your heart speaks to, and make it a part of your breath. Whenever after a while, it becomes your nature. When you're waiting for someone, you start chanting. Instead of constantly looking at your feed on Facebook, you can actually chant Gayatri when you're waiting. And of course, morning, noon, and evening. I also read somewhere that when we chant around noon, the Gayatri benefits our Pitrus. Those are ancestors who are in heaven. It goes, even aids them. It has an intergenerational impact. And it is so powerful. You're laying out a very good path for generations to come in your family. And it also benefits those who have gone before you. So everything, it's the other thing that I read about the Gayatri Mantra, it's like, you know, every night when you say thanks to Swami for the wonderful day you have offered everything with Karacharana Kritam Vak at Swami's lotus feet, and you chant the Gayatri, it is you bought something from the store and you paid it on your debit card and you cleared your debt. So if you buy it on your credit card, you have to pay the money at the end of the month or at the end of the payment cycle. But when you pay it on the spot through Google Pay or Amazon Pay, you paid on the spot and the money is gone and you're debt free. So karmic debt also, in case we have made omissions and commissions during the course of the day, I mean, that doesn't give us a license to live any kind of crazy lifestyle, okay? Let's not get confused here. But if inadvertently we have spoken harshly to someone, we have done something we could have done much better, once we chant the Gayatri, we clear our wrongdoing and the burden of that karma before we go to bed, and go to bed with a clean slate. Mamta Mishra says, is there any number or chanting like 3, 6? As I just said, Mamta, entirely your wish. You can minimum 3 is a nice start. 9 is a good number. 21 even better. And up to you. Anything. You can do 108 Kamala. You can do anything. Amruta Venkata Ramani says, if I have one doubt, many times it's difficult to keep thinking of God. If not able to recite from heart, then it has no use. Correct. We should do it mindfully, not like a parrot, right? So there's a very nice book that I read when I prepared for this topic. It is written by Swami Om. And Swami Om says, very nice technique that Swami Om, Swamiji uses. He says, as he chants each line, he visualizes a drop of water going tip down. So he imagines, he visualizes the impact of the mantra getting it, washing you off or filling you with light. So when you say Om Bhur Bhuva Swaha Tat Savitur Vareniyam, visualize the drop of water cleansing you on the inside. Bhargo Devasya Dhimahi. Another, so do it mindfully, do it slowly. Diyo Yona Prachodayat. And I do it when I'm cooking, and halfway through the cooking, if I have to shout at somebody, I forget my mantra halfway, but then I come back to it. And if I'm chopping my vegetables, I always try my best to chant so that the food I prepare becomes Naivedyam. I don't do it that often, but even if I'm reheating the food, I constantly chant before we serve dinner, because sometimes the dinner is in the fridge and you take it out and you warm it. At that time also, I chant while I'm serving my family. If I'm passing a bowl of dal, I try my best to chant so that that becomes Naivedyam. Whether my family members chant the Brahmarpanam or Gayatri is their business. My business is to make sure that whatever passes through my hands, I'm emitting the Gayatri vibration to the extent possible, right? So we are all works in progress. Shouldn't get so, and you know what? It will start with the mechanical chanting, but it grows very deep and it becomes sweeter and leaves a blissful feeling inside. It's like on a cold day, you take a nice hot shower. It's like a shower on the inside, the Gayatri mantra. It makes you feel so nurtured, safe and clean and well. So Amata, don't let it bother you. Please chant it. Even if it comes mechanically initially, then it will become meaningful with practice. Kumar Raghavan wants to know, chanting loudly or mentally? Very good question, brother. There's a whole mantra science to it. What it is, if we are doing congregational, we are doing Laksharchana, obviously loudly. Otherwise, there are three different ways to chanting. One is softly but moving your lips. Okay? So the loudest is for congregational. But the better version is silently but movement of tongue and lips. But the bestest version, the most superior, is pin drop silence, no movement, but inside your chanting. There's a whole science. I can actually walk you through it and I have all the information, but it won't fit in this particular satsang. So, because you're not expending any energy in creating a sound vibration, you're internalizing its power completely and the effulgence, it will unravel. The light is within. The light has to come to the fourth, and that process gets hastened when you chant it in absolute silence, no movement of lips internally. That is the most potent. Next one, silent lip movement. But for congregational gatherings, it's good to chant aloud and create that sound vibration. Any more questions, please? Yes. So the question that I've been asked, I think if time is up, I'm absolutely ready to offer Aarti to Bhagwan Baba.
Om Jai Jagadish Hari, Swami Sathya Sai Hari, Bhakta Jana Samrakshaka, Bhakta Jana Samrakshaka, Pati Maheshwara, Om Jai Jagadish Hari, Shashi Vadana Shri Tara, Sarva Pranapati, Swami Sarva Pranapati, Ashrita Kalpalatika.
जय